Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. I'm back with another video. And you know, while I was just praying, I was praising and worshiping the Lord. And there's a song I was listening to, and it says, you know, my soul worships you. You know, it was saying, you know, with my soul, I'm worshiping you, Lord. And while I was laying there praying, I had the word in tongues, it just came out of my mouth, Magnificat, Magnificat. Magnificat. And I've heard that term before. It's a Latin term, and it's referring to a text from the Bible, because I went to Bible school, so that's the only reason why I know it. I know that Magnificat refers to the prayer of Mary, or the prophecy of Mary when she went to Elizabeth's house. It's called the Magnificat. But I didn't know that the meaning of that word from Latin is, you know, it's my soul magnifies the Lord. So my soul doth magnify the Lord. So the song I was listening to was saying, you know, my soul magnifies the Lord, or similar words. It wasn't magnify. I can't remember what it is. No, it's another word. My soul exalts the Lord, or something like that. So the Lord gave me, it just came out of my mouth while I was praying and singing the song, mixed in with the words I was saying, came out the word Magnificat. This is a great example, even though, you know, I knew that word, and I knew it referred to this prophecy of Mary, but I didn't know that the word Magnificat referred to that expression, you know, my soul doth magnify the Lord. And that's what I was saying, my soul exalts the Lord, or something in English at the same time. This is a way of how, you know, and I'm mentioning this in a video because these are the things that happens to me all the time, where it confirms to me, even though I already know it, it confirms to me that I'm hearing from the Lord. It builds my individual faith. It's like you guys. You know, these are stepping stones of building our faith, that we can give people words of wisdom and words of knowledge, and we can know that we're hearing from God through these kind of a things, brothers and sisters, through these kinds of a thing. As a matter of fact, I was on Facebook and talking to a sister today, and we were talking about a political figure, and both of us typed. This is a sister, you know, and her husband, who we visited before and were friends with, from the U.S. And we both said the same thing about this political figure, but just in different words at the exact same time. As I sent mine, she sent hers. This is just an example, as, you know, I felt the Holy Spirit when I wrote that. We were just saying things, and boom, it just came from the Lord to say that, and she said it at the same time. You know, it's like a confirmation from the Lord. Now, these kind of things, brothers and sisters, it's daily. You know, this is, as Sid Rawl says, you know, it's naturally supernatural. To naturally be a Christian is to operate in the supernatural. Supernatural life is normal and natural for Christians. But so many Christians are walking without power. Let's look at this text, brothers and sisters. Luke chapter 1, from verse 46 to 55. I want to read this to you, because not only did the Lord give me that in a confirmation of what I was singing in English at the same time, but there's a message here from the Lord, brothers and sisters, and I don't know what all it is. You know, when I start making videos, because God is training me and practicing me in the prophetic ministry and all that, like the words of wisdom that I made the videos of for 15 years, the Lord is always having me to study the word and pray. And then when I, you know, as he said, you know, don't think in advance what you're going to say. And then I'm telling you, 99% of the videos I make, I have no idea what I'm going to say. I might have one subject, one Bible verse or whatever, and I just go with it. And then flow in the Spirit. And, you know, there's lots of you who watch my videos because God has also got you in that kind of a prophetic, you know. As they say, birds of a feather flock together. And so there's different types of ministries, and people have different, you know, giftings and callings. And we usually, you know, we would work together. And that's how God operates. There's school in the Bible, in the Old Testament. They had schools of the prophets and all this kind of stuff. So we tend to flow, like people that love evangelism. Well, of course, they probably follow Billy Graham Ministries or whatever, you know, Franklin Graham Ministries, because that's their thing, right? That's their calling from God. So praise God. Let's look at the text. Luke chapter 1, starting at verse 46, when Mary had come into the house of Elizabeth, Elizabeth said, you know, the babe leaps in my womb, and she had given a word from the Lord. And, you know, her husband had given a word before this, you know, about the pregnancy. Oh, after this, actually, his mouth was loose, and he gave also a prophecy. And now the thing about Luke, who wrote Luke, the physician Luke, who wrote Luke and wrote Acts, he always gives emphasis to the being the power of the Holy Spirit. So when you read his writings, he gives emphasis that it's the power of God moving more than the other writers in the New Testament does. So we see him, letting the story, mention that it's the Holy Spirit speaking. In the other books of the Bible, you know, it's God is speaking through people, but it doesn't say specifically, oh, God was speaking through them. But Luke is really good about that, I guess because he's a physician. He's thinking about this. This is some kind of a supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. Like Peter in the book of Acts, he said, being filled with the Holy Spirit, stood up and spoke to the Sanhedrin, you know. So as an example, that's also Luke who wrote that. Okay, anyway, so Luke chapter 1, verse 46. And Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. That's the Magnificat, as they say in Latin. This text right here I'm reading to you, it's known in high theologians as the Magnificat, because she says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. You know, and the Lord is just telling me that when we look at this text, you know, lots of times we read Bible text, but we don't really look at it and focus on it. Listen, she says, my soul doth magnify the Lord. And I just made the video before this one. I should have mentioned in that. When you're talking about praying in the Spirit, we're talking about worshiping the Lord. We magnify Him. We focus like a magnifying glass. You know, we're zooming in. We're focusing on God. We're, you know, seeing Him as what He is. Big, 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 big to us. Where my soul doth magnify the Lord. Not my natural way, but my spirit, brothers and sisters. As a matter of fact, now I see where the Lord is going with that. This afternoon I was thinking about that. How that lots of people, you know, they're not magnifying the Lord, and they don't see things through the lens of magnifying the Lord. They see it through their flesh. That's why when people talk about, they can't understand about speaking in tongues and all that, it's like they're magnifying their flesh. They're like, I can't understand what somebody's saying and all that. Well, of course, it's supernatural. You have to have an interpretation. Of course, it's things we can't understand. People being healed and getting up out of a wheelchair and walking. As Sister Rosemary had said, you know, in her church, a little girl went up and told this old lady to get out of the wheelchair and walk, and she did. I mean, these things are beyond our understanding. You know, but it's God. It's the magnification of the Lord. Hallelujah. It's God on display, showing His love every time something happens against what's the normal way of creation that God made. It's called a miracle. It's called a magnification of God when someone gets saved. As Jesus said, you know, those the kingdom of heaven since the time of John the Baptist till now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcefully advancing. And those that take it by force. Amen. So when someone gets saved, it's a victory. It's a spiritual warfare that you can't see. When someone's in a wheelchair, that's a whole other teaching. I guess the Lord is leading me to get into that. You know, when Jesus healed the one woman on the Sabbath and they said, hey, what are you doing? He said, you know, don't you, if you have an ox or a donkey that, or whatever, a mule that falls into a pit, you don't go get it out? And here this woman's been bound by Satan for these 18 years. I think I said it like the church lady for a minute there. Can't you see this woman was bound by Satan for 18 years? And then shouldn't we let her free, even if it's on the Sabbath, Jesus said? So who bound her? Satan. Who bound her? Satan. And then the Lord was magnified by setting her free. So, you know, that's a whole other teaching. Lots of times people keep talking about, oh, God put the sickness on me and all that. God's not putting sicknesses on people. God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love Him, who are called according to His purposes, Romans 8:28. Then the Lord does chastise people. But the Lord, if you're being chastised by the Lord, it wouldn't do any good for you to be chastised if you didn't know you were being chastised. You know, if you're like, oh, I'm not sure what's going on. If God's chastising you for you to learn a lesson, you have to find out what's going on. So that you can, you know, when you punish a child, there's a reason. And then you're developing them and growing them in that. It's not a God keeping secrets and mysteries from us. So most of the time, you're talking about sickness and disease. It's part of this fallen world, and it's a result of the sinful nature of the world, our sinful nature and everyone around us. We are in this fallen world. Probably the number one questions I get asked or got asked when I was new in the ministry was, well, you know, why do people die? Why do Christians get sick? Why do Christians die? Because we're living in a fallen world. We're living in a fallen world. And, you know, we're surrounded by sin and sickness and disease. What did God say in His Word? I don't know how I got on this topic exactly, but by the grace of God, What did God tell Adam and Eve? He said, when you, before that Adam and Eve ate the fruit, there was no death, no sickness, and no disease. That was all a result of the fall. And God said, when you eat the fruit, and the day you eat the fruit, you will surely die. And they did die. One day with the Lord is 1,000 years with man. If you notice, no man lived past 1,000 years. The oldest one was Methuselah, who lived to be 969. I think Adam was 939, something like that, 935, 939. He was right up in there, almost to that one day of the Lord, 1,000 years. So sickness and disease is a result of the fall, a result of sin in this fallen world. So that's why we die, because we're in this world. Our spirit's been redeemed. That's why, as Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. Her soul did. She was still in the flesh, just like the rest of us. Contrary to the teachings of Rome, Mary was not born. You know, people hear that expression, Protestants, and you know, and I don't even like the term Protestants. That's the old mainline denominations. Born-again Christians hear the expression, the Immaculate Conception, and they think it's talking about Jesus. But no, the Immaculate Conception is a term that says that Mary was born to a woman named Anne, which we don't know Mary's mother's name, but it was made up, that her name was Anne, and that she was born without sin, that Mary was born without sin, so that she could have Jesus. That's the false doctrine of, comes from Rome, the Immaculate Conception. But Mary is a member of the church. Mary was born in sin like all of us. She was a handmaiden of the Lord, a servant of the Lord. Let's read the rest of the text. And Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. You remember, brothers and sisters, I talked about the Hebrew poetry in the video I made yesterday, and the words of knowledge when I made my last video, Words for Those Who Ask, 19, I think it is. In Hebrew poetry, it'll, and this is New Testament, you don't see it much in the New Testament. This is an example where you see something repeated in different words. You make one statement like the fool is easily confused, and the person that's a stooge will be misunderstood. Well, it misunderstands everything. And I know that's not in the Bible. I'm trying to think of one right now. That's an example. I just repeated it in different words. So here we see Mary saying, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior. So it's kind of repeating of the same words. And of course, she's saying, God is my Savior. That's what Yeshua means. My rejoice in God my Savior. For he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. Now this is one that you will also know that I'm always mentioned, if I need to, by the Spirit of God. When you go into a born-again church, lots of times, you know, because the over-exaltation and magnification, Mary has been magnified, you know, Our Lady of Guadalupe, Our Lady of Fatima, and all these apparitions and stuff, and idolizing and making an idol and worship of Mary so much that there's lots of evangelicals who are disrespectful to the Blessed Virgin Mary. So right here, Mary is telling us, by the Spirit of God, and henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. So we, all Christians, should call Mary the Blessed Virgin Mary, because that's what she said that she would be called by the unction of God, and it's right here in our Bible, Luke chapter 1, verse 48. So she is the Blessed Virgin. Verse 49, Luke chapter 1, verse 49. For he that is mighty has done to me great things. Holy is his name. He and his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. Brothers and sisters, you have to, you know, we do fear the Lord. And as they say, there's always these modern day touchy-feely saddleback, brokeback pastors who try to change the word from fear, like holy respect. The word is fear. We should fear the Lord. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Yes, we should fear the holiness and righteousness of God, and know that but for his grace, you know, we would be in hell. As Paul said, by his grace I am what I am. By God's grace. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works, lest any man should boast. So his grace, unmerited, unearned favor. If it wasn't for that, we would be just like, you know, burn up. When the Lord would look at us, we'd just be burned up in hellfire, and that's it. But by his grace, he chose to have a relationship with us. Never forget that. The Bible says we're enemies. People that are not Christians are enemies of God. All this stuff, like, we're all children of God. No, we're all the creation of God. John chapter 1, all who believe on his name, to them he gave power, Jesus gave power, to become the children of God. So through belief on his name, through faith in Christ, by becoming born again, we can become children of God by grace through faith. But before that, the Bible says we're enemies and strangers of the covenants of God, lost and without hope in the world. So, but by his grace, we were enemies. We were born as enemies of God in fallen sin. All this new modern day teaching, that's all straight lies and candy coated stuff from the pit of hell. And it does, you know, look at the largest church in the United States. The largest church in the United States is in Houston. What's his name? Joel Osteen. Sugar-coated, candy-coated poison. Candy-coated poison. Brothers and sisters, praise God that you, if you're seeing this video and you haven't heard any real preaching in your life, if you're not, you know, when I was a little kid, we used to go to the rural mountain areas. I had an uncle that was a Baptist preacher in the rural mountain areas, and that was in the 70s. They're still preaching old-school, hardcore, real preaching. You know, that was just a few and far between. Even in the 70s, it was already going down the tubes. Praise God, I got to see some real preaching when I was a kid, you know, of what the real gospel. Let's see. Luke chapter 1, verse 50. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. Of course, in whom is the right arm of the Lord revealed? Of course, Isaiah chapter 53, Christ is who we're talking about here, the Messiah. He has shown strength with his arm. Yes, that's the Christ. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. Jesus was born in a manger. He chose Mary, you know, who was not from a wealthy family. You know, she was betrothed to a carpenter. This average people. You know, not rich people, not born in a palace, but born in a manger, the Christ, and wrapped in rags, swaddling clothes. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has sent empty away. He has hopened his servant Israel. In remembrance, that's helped in modern English. He has opened his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he has spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. That last part is for Israel. And the Lord had, you know, give me a word for that. I need to make a video for that. Of course, what he's saying there, this is for the end times. That he has not forgotten Israel, and to his seed forever, the natural seed of Abraham. Praise God. He's, you know, he's exalted those of low degree, and he has filled the hungry with good things. You know, the Lord Jesus there in the Sermon on the Mount, you know, at the Beatitudes, you know, blessed are those who are hungry, they shall be filled. You know, blessed are those who mourn thou, mourn now. We mourn in this life for the sin of this world, you know, because then we'll have joy. Those that have all the, you know, joy now, they're going to mourn at that time. Those who are full now, they're going to be hungry at that time. Of course, the Lord is not talking about don't eat and don't have a nice day. He's talking about people who are rejoicing in sin. And Mary here is referring to that same text that the Lord used at the Beatitudes. Those people who are wealthy in the things of the world, wealthy in the things of man, living, you know, a compromised, sinful life. There's a day coming which is upon us now. That's why the Lord gave me this text. You know, it's called the tribulation period. It's upon us. When those who are rich will go away empty-handed. And then when those same people die, like the story of the rich man and Lazarus, you know, they're separated from the Lord. They're going to the pit. They're going to hell. Praise God, brothers and sisters, that just like Mary, I want to say this from the Spirit of the living God. Praise the Lord, just like Mary was minding her own business. Let me go look at the text. Let me back this text up. If I can get it to come up here. Let me look at the text. Hold on a minute, because I'm using my... says, and it came... Let's see, when Mary... Let's see. I'm getting there. Give me a moment. Because I've got it all squashed up on one side because I've got this camera on the other side. Let's look at what happened to... You know, about, let's see, I'm trying to go back before 46. See, and in the verse 26, Luke chapter 1, verse 26, in the 6 months of the angel, you know, the pregnancy of John, the mother of John with John, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women. And then she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, cast her mind what manner of salutation this would be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Yeshua, or Jesus, here in the text, the King James text. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing as I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto him, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow thee. Therefore also the holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the 6 months with her, who was called barren. For God, nothing is impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaiden of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. That's what I wanted to read that to you, brothers and sisters, to get this text. People read it at Christmas and all this kind of stuff. Listen, Mary was just a nobody minding her own business, and God called her and chose her. Just like he did the disciples. Jesus said in John, You know, you didn't choose me. I chose you, he told the apostles in the Gospel of Matthew. I chose you. So God chose me. God chose you. God chose us to serve him and to be Christians. Praise God. My soul doth magnify the Lord because he has chosen his servant, Patrick, to be his servant, to be a follower of Jesus, to be a disciple. Praise God. Is your soul magnifying the Lord because the Lord had called you? Just like that song, He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love goes to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Hallelujah! Victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He sought me and he bought me with his blood. He did the same thing to you. If you're a born again Christian, the Lord called you unto himself. Jesus said, No man comes to me unless the Father draws them. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let your soul magnify the Lord. That's why it's so important, brothers and sisters, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to be baptized with the Holy Spirit, so that as go back to the text that, you know, I've been on it for 2 days now because the Lord wants me to teach you guys and talk about it. When Paul said, it's not me that prayeth, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, but my soul is praying. My spirit prays. My spirit is magnifying the Lord. My spirit is praying when I'm praying in the spirit. Therefore, Jude says, build up your most holy faith, praying in the spirit. Hallelujah. So when you will be speaking in tongues in your private prayer language, you're praying in the spirit. Your soul is magnifying the Lord. I want to say this though too, brothers and sisters. Of course, we can also magnify the Lord the way Mary did with our natural voice and worship the Lord and honor him through praise and worship and all those things. And like I'm doing right now, I'm magnifying the Lord. He's great and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Bless his holy name. See, I just magnified the Lord. Hallelujah. The Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. Praise God. Praise God Almighty, through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and all you creatures here below, whatever that I got it mixed up. God bless you guys, brothers and sisters. You know that I love you guys. I love the opportunity to minister to you guys, and I'm going to make a video to pray for those people who want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, as the Spirit of the Lord would allow me. I got, you know, still got about 20 or 30 people on the list for words of wisdom, words of knowledge, and then a sister, that same sister where we, I mentioned in the last video how we said the same thing at the same time, almost but different words about a political leader. Brothers and sisters, you know, she had also reminded me that I need to remind you guys about our prayer request to build these two orphanages. Now, praise God, we've had about, if it's not one-fourth. We've had some funds to come in, brothers and sisters. And I'm praying and believing, and those of you who are praying in agreement with me, that we're believing for $150,000 to build these two orphanages complete, to pay for them, and we need furniture and all that kind of stuff, and everything needed, you know, all those little things. It takes all those things, the beds and, you know, and everything that we need, and to cook and everything, plates and everything. So I thank you, brothers and sisters, who are praying and agreeing with me for the $150,000. And I think we got and I don't want to say the amount, I think it's about $25,000 that we've raised separate from a regular budget. We're adding two orphanages, so we have two orphanages now, so our budget for the orphanages will double. Our monthly budget, that's, you know, so we have to increase our budget plus raise this extra money. Plus, the Lord, you know, when I went down there to do that revival, I met with some of the pastors that we do the feedings with, and of course, there's a medical doctor there. He's an optometrist, an eye doctor. He's going to make a video for me telling about how much, you know, the Lord has moved through our feeding programs. So, and they're going to make a video. He's supposed to be working on it, send it to me. I should have made it while I was there, but I had so many people to meet with, I couldn't do it myself. And so I asked him to make it and send it to me. So I hope that he does soon. I'm going to put it on here. But, you know, we're feeding 800 kids a week at our feeding program, and we want to increase it. Just even to, you know, I'm going to make it 1,000 right now, increase it to 1,000 this month. But I'd like to make it 2,000 or 10,000, whatever the Lord would let us do. So I asked you, invite you to join our Facebook group. You can see the pictures of the feeding programs and orphans. I post some pictures almost every day, you know, 3 or 4 pictures, like a daily dose of the orphans and the feeding programs and all this kind of stuff. You can go back through the archives and see it all the way back to when we started it, like in September 2012. See all the things we're doing. All the information is there. You can check it out. And I praise God, you know, lots of you guys said you're going to come over here and visit. I'll be glad when some of you guys come visit when I'm here. I'll be back here again, probably the same time next year if the Lord doesn't return. I'll be back here again to build the fourth orphanage. Just, you know, the third one we're trying to, it's going to be up and running before I leave. The fourth one we're going to do when I come back next time. But, you know, I got to have the, you know, everything, the funds for construction and all that. So that's what I'm trying to raise right now. And if I had the money now, I'd start building it right now. Praise God. I know the Lord will provide. God bless you guys. You know I love you. I appreciate you guys. I appreciate that people ask me questions, theological stuff. And that's why I'm on YouTube for, to answer theological questions. As long as people are being respectful and in love and generally genuinely want to know some information, I'm here to help you. You know, but people start being mocking and ridiculing and obnoxious and all that. Hey, I don't have time to play with you because there's tons of people I can help. And, you know, it's like this, you know, it's just like I mentioned before, I was, you know, a paramedic in the Army. And then we have a word that they call triage, which is a French word. It means sorting. You know, so you got the rule is to do the most good for the most people in the least amount of time. So, you know, you have to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, and know when to walk away and know when to run. So as a pastor, the hardest part of being a pastor is, you know, discerning when you can help people and when you can't, you know, and then, you know, and because when you're a pastor, you serve the Lord. I mean, I serve the Lord, not only being a Christian, but I serve the Lord. I give an account to the Lord for anything I teach, anything I do. So I want to, you know, we all make mistakes, but I don't want to make any errors. You know, someone that I'm short with could have been somebody that I could have really helped. And there's people that I've spent lots of time trying to help. And then later on you realize, hey, this person's only clowning with you and gaming you. And during that time, I could have helped 10 other people. You see what I mean? So that's the hardest part of being a pastor, is quickly discerning and evaluating either by the Lord leading you or by just natural observation. And God gave us common sense too. You can figure out if you can help people or not. And I would just say, praise God, 90% of the people I dealt with are great people. And I thank the Lord for all of you guys, you know, or maybe it's 95%. It's only those few people. You know, you can't let those few people get you all stirred up and get you all fired up and get you off into the flesh. And, you know, those thorns in the flesh and, the devil's little fiery dart and his little minions. You know, we just have to learn to, you know, to subdue our flesh and walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh so that we will not be, you know, drawn into that. So praise God. I mean, that's probably the greatest benefit for YouTube, for me personally, you know, is a growth in handling crazy people, the devil's people. So I thank God for that. It's much faster than in, you know, because I've been pastor of churches before. I planted lots of churches. I pastored churches. And so it's a much slower process when you're only working with the same people, you know, 200 or 300 people. You know, some of the group I work with is like 50 and some was 200 or 300. You work with those people and it's the same people, so you get to know them. But with the internet, brothers and sisters, as you guys know, if you're on here a lot, you know, you're dealing with new people every day that you don't even know anything about them. You don't even see their face, maybe, just their comments and stuff. So it's a much higher level, you know, when you know you can't see their body language and all that kind of stuff. And so it's much more complicated, and it's easy to misinterpret what someone's saying from just words. You can read it in the wrong way when it's not that way, or you can read it in a good light when it's really bad, you know, sometimes. So, you know, praise God for that. It's a whole new thing, the internet, you know, for a lot, you know, for us to learn how to use this for the glory of God, the internet, for the glory of God. So praise God for that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. And I'm going to be I'm working on the list. If I haven't called your name, when I finish my list, I'll announce, hey, that's all I had. And then if I didn't call your name and you asked me for a word, well, you'll just have to ask me again. I'm trying to keep up with it. But I've got a running list, and I got about 20 or 30 names on there now. And I'm going to try to do those in the next couple of days. And then I'm going to make a video about to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And as the Lord leads me and whatever else. But I had a dream today. I had another dream, and I heard some people talking about when's the tribulation and the rapture and all that. And then they said, oh, we know. Here it is written down right here. And then they showed it, and it was said 2015. I just throw that on the end. The people that watch this video all the way to the end, you heard it. Ha, ha, ha. I just hit it right in there for those who would watch this video to the end. That's a little reward for you for another little confirmation from the Lord. And in my dream, it woke me up. It surprised me. It's like right in my face. It was written down in gold writing on a piece of paper, 2015. And boom, it was right in my face. And it just like jarred me. And I woke up and I was like, man, is that for real? Is it just a dream or is it from the Lord, you know? So anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. God bless you.